This is Babette Babich, and I teach philosophy at Fordham University, and I'm repeating a radio interview, podcast, as they are now recorded as a podcast, between Beth Matthews in Melbourne, Australia, and myself. One caveat to underline is that this is not a reconstruction or repetition of everything said in a live interview, but a reprise. The reprise is necessary because, and this happens unfortunately all the time with phone interviews, the audio on my part was effectively inaudible. So no audio one could hear, and that's terrible in a radio interview. Thus, and by contrast, when I spoke to John Faithful Hamer as a guest on his fascinating podcast with a great title called Likeville, New York City's high winds interfered that day. But at least something was hearable. You could certainly hear the wind, the whistling of the wind, and my voice. By contrast, the same cannot be said from my side of the interview for Beth Matthews' Radical Philosophy radio show for 3CR 855 AM Community Radio in Melbourne. Here, I'll follow the format of a video interview done by Sierra Fox and Paulina Tam, Fordham undergraduate videographers and reporters for The Observer, that's the newspaper down at Lincoln Center's Fordham College, Lincoln Center, when they interviewed me in my office at Lincoln Center 5 years ago for Women's History Month. I talked about Simone de Beauvoir. They replaced, and I found that format interesting, their own questions to me as silent intervals, white on black, in the video they produced. And I'll try to add a link to that here. I studied philosophy after first beginning as a student of the biological sciences at the State University of Stony Brook in New York State. It's a great university for the biological sciences. However, I learned very quickly that in order to study biology, one had to kill. One had to destroy cells. Even cell culture or cytology involves that. One had to dissect animals, which I did in comparative vertebrate anatomy. And in general, experimentation involved harming animals. Plus, biology didn't ask the question, what is life? Which as a young person bothered me, logically speaking. Thus, to understand science, biological science, better, I switched to philosophy. Now there, I was really in luck, because Stony Brook had a department that had originally been set up by a physicist who was an expert in Werner Heisenberg, but also in Edmund Husserl on logic and Heidegger on technology. That was Patrick Heelan, who taught me philosophy of science and hired excellent people, including David Allison, who taught me Nietzsche, and Don Eide, who taught me the philosophy of technology. I read Gadamer at Stony Brook, and when I learned that Gadamer himself was teaching at Boston College, I went there for my doctorate starting in 1980. The thing about grad school, as I'm sure you No, I'm sure everyone knows, is that it's all about the scholars one meets, but it's also all about the courses one chooses to take. I studied theology, and I went to a lot of lectures on philosophy of science at BU, Boston University. I was the first person at BC to get a Fulbright to Germany. This was a good thing, because when one person in a department gets one, others are more likely to get one in the future. It kind of puts the department on the map for funding opportunities. I read philosophy in Tübingen and Berlin, so learning German in Göttingen made all the difference. And then I went on to learn French in Tours because of Descartes. He's from Tours and or the area around Tours. And I spent a year writing my dissertation and studying philosophy in Belgium, in Brussels and Louvain-la-Neuve, where I worked with the late Jacques Tamignot, brilliant thinker on German idealism, art and law, who died this past May, 2019, and who directed my dissertation on Nietzsche's perspectival aesthetics and truth. I remain passionate about Nietzsche. I continue to edit New Nietzsche Studies, a journal I founded, but I still write on aesthetics and epistemology, including philosophy of science and philosophy of technology. I played the cello when I was younger. And that was enough to be completely struck by the instrument. I'm also keen on contrabass, At the same time, I also sought to understand the difference between popular music, including jazz, and so-called classical music, and I didn't think current philosophy of music was very useful, as it seemed to come down to personal appreciation and little more of the I like jazz or I like Dylan or, in my case, I like Leonard Cohen variety. Plato, who said explicitly Pythagorean things about music, called such enthusiasm mere opinion, and I thought there has to be more. Nietzsche's first book was entitled The Birth of Tragedy Out of the Spirit of Music. And although almost all scholars, nearly without exception, read that first book as fairly irrelevant when it comes to understanding either Nietzsche or ancient tragedy, but rather as Nietzsche fanboying Wagner, I could not but note, this is why the cello seems to help, that Nietzsche spent an awful lot of time talking Beethoven, who, in a musical mode, transposed Schiller's poem, The Ode to Joy, the German of it, into the Ninth Symphony, which occupies Nietzsche from the start to the finish of The Birth of Tragedy. He quotes that. In fact, he hardly talks enough Wagner to be a proper fanboy. Wagner was surely disappointed by the lack of reference. Nietzsche insisted, and I continue to be struck by the cool clarity of his argument, that we ought to understand ancient tragedy contra Aristotle. As a Stagirite, Aristotle was not himself part of the culture of Greece in the Tragic Age, but he determines what many to this day believe to be tragedy, defining it, as he does, as eliciting feelings, specifically pity and fear, for the sake of catharsis, purification. Nietzsche points out that this definition makes zero sense. Is pity what we feel for Orestes when he executes his revenge on his mother, Clytemnestra, also killing her lover Aegisthus for their joint murder of his father Agamemnon, who started everything by murdering, that is, sacrificing, Orestes' sister, Iphigenia? And the feeling of fear likewise seems imprecise, though that may be true of a horror movie, and although in the case of, say, the Oedipus trilogies, there might be a moment where we with Jocasta might hope that Oedipus stops short of figuring out who he is, that hope corresponds neither to pity nor fear. Finally, catharsis. What exactly is discharged? Key to the problem, and here a little neuroscience helps, is the generic question of whether purgative emotions could be repeatedly elicited, just speaking physically. That's back to the biologist in me. As Nietzsche points out, the stories, all of them, were already known. There's no surprise. Tragedy, this is his comparison, is more like the religious tradition of high mass than the theater we know. Every tragic poet composed a music drama featuring the same characters, same plot. Orestes, Agamemnon, Prometheus, Oedipus, Pentheus, etc. Dionysus is part of that. The Bacchae. The Greeks binged watched their tragedies in a great festival, hearing the same music dramas from one poet after another, dawn to dusk, and into the night, everyone watching one after another, sets of three, followed by another set of three. And they did this for days in a religious context, as were the Olympic Games, a competition where the notion of pity and fear to elicit purging emotion makes, just as Nietzsche thought, zero sense. Thus, Nietzsche argued that tragedy was born out of the spirit of this religious folk music festival. I should add that I was interested in music of the present day, and because I was interested in technology, I wondered about the difference made by different media, by musical reproduction. What was the difference between records and tapes, they used to have them, and CDs and MP3s, but also genre differences. Thus, I thought that Adorno was onto something that wasn't reducible to simply denouncing his views, as these seem poorly understood in any case, on jazz. I thought what Adorno, and remember that he was a composer of the new music that we have yet to begin to listen to, I thought he was talking about something a lot more complicated. The first philosophy book I ever read was Plato's Republic, because there it was on my father's bookshelf, but that doesn't count. The book that made me who I am, that was astounding for me, was Kant's Critique of Pure Reason, which I read without stopping night and day until I finished it. I've read it and taught it many times since, and I continue to find it extraordinary. After that, I'd be fascinated by the pre-Socratic philosophy, the fragments to be found in what is now Kirkraven and Schofield. That was very influential. And there's another book that had a formative effect, and that was Heidegger's Being and Time. I'm still reading it. In addition to pretty much every word Nietzsche ever wrote, published and unpublished. In a way, reading Nietzsche as I read him as a Kantian, that is, in terms of a forcefully radical epistemology, including Nietzsche's thinking on logic and science in particular, would be the book, you could say, the thing, the activity that made me who I am as a scholar and a thinker. But I read a lot, and to this day, and I try to cite those authors in what I write. Words in Blood, like flowers, is indebted in fairly equal parts to Heidegger and to Hölderlin and to Nietzsche, especially Nietzsche's reading of poetry, including the ancient troubadour tradition, and including Hölderlin and, of course, the Greeks. The title of the book is completely stolen, word for word, one bit from Nietzsche, who wrote that we should only trust things written in blood, that tis, with heart and passion, but also pain, involving both sacrifice and generosity. That is hermeneutic love. The other part of the title was borrowed, was stolen from Hölderlin, who speaks of the poetic moment as an event in which words, like flowers, can come to birth, are able to be born or emerge into being. I teach very classical philosophy, which means that I read only original sources. I do it the old school way. This means that I don't typically have recourse to my own books in my classes, but in a recent course on philosophy and poetry, beginning with ancient poetry, including Anne Carson's wonderful Eros the Bittersweet, where she, herself a poet, discusses Sappho and Archilochus, I found that I needed Nietzsche on Archilochus, discussed in key chapters in Nietzsche's The Birth of Tragedy. Now, most Nietzsche scholars are baffled by Nietzsche's claims for Archilochus, insisting, as Nietzsche does, that the ancients ranked him side by side with Homer as top poet and mumbled, well, Dionysus, as if that explained anything. In providing context, Words in Blood Like Flowers is a good book for a course on philosophy and poetry because it includes, it discusses Nietzsche on tragedy and music along with Carson's poets Sappho and Pindar, as well as Heidegger's poets Hölderlin, Rilke, George, as well as Heidegger's origin of the work of art, which I undertake to look at in terms of architecture and plays. That's a very difficult question, because on the one hand, Heidegger couldn't have been nastier to Nietzsche if he tried, and he seems to have tried. According to Heidegger, Nietzsche didn't ask what Heidegger called the being question, but who, apart from Heidegger, ever did? Nietzsche, Heidegger tells us, was the so-called last metaphysician. According to both Heidegger and Nietzsche, it's not a good thing to be a metaphysician, and Nietzsche denied that he was. But on the other hand, all Heidegger does is talk Nietzsche. He invokes Nietzsche more than he invokes Aristotle and more than Kant. Indeed, some scholars have argued that Heidegger models some of his later writing on Nietzsche. I don't agree entirely because this is an sich impossible. No one can copy Nietzsche. His style turns out to be inimitable, but also because there was clearly some anxiety. Additionally, there is a mystery, because at the end of his life, Heidegger would repeat repeatedly that Nietzsche had ruined or destroyed him. Nietzsche hat mich kaputt gemacht, is what his son said he walked around saying. I don't claim to know what Heidegger meant by saying Nietzsche destroyed me. The claim is quite strange. It's a rosebud moment, as in the film Citizen Kane. And in movies, such cinematic moments absorb viewers, quite because the screen offers one an opportunity to project one's own meaning. You see a little sled, you think whatever you like. Quite beginning with the screenplay writers, the directors, the actors, the audience too gets in on it. But in the case of Heidegger, there's also the matter, and that's what makes it inscrutable, of the personal. There's a further issue, inasmuch as it is Heidegger who invites us to read Nietzsche more seriously than we tend to do. To this day, most philosophers do not regard Nietzsche as a particularly challenging thinker, not by comparison with Kant, or Fichte, or Frege, or even Heidegger. In fact, just to go back to Kant, there's a little cottage industry of scholars dedicated to arguing that Nietzsche never read Kant, or only read his Third Critique, which I disagree with, and I argue for my part that Nietzsche read all three critiques. To be sure, those committed to Nietzsche's scholarship know that he was an extraordinary scholar, that is, that he read a lot. So perhaps folks think that if they can prove that Nietzsche read little, they won't need to read much for their own part. This goes hand in glove with those who reduce Nietzsche to Wagner and others who insist he channeled Emerson or else Schopenhauer. And years ago, there were those who argued that Nietzsche be reduced to Friedrich Lange, the author of a work on materialism. But people haven't read Lange for years, so it's mostly Emerson these days. I believe Heidegger can help us read Nietzsche without flailing about for a guide rail, be it Emerson or Lange or Schopenhauer, owing to Heidegger's transformation of phenomenology. That's why Heidegger looks at language as he looks at a tool, at science, modern technology, human existence, life and death, immediacy and history, to ask us to think through what addresses us, speaks and bespeaks us in language, what in our tools and worldly engagements comes to hand, and by the same token, transforms our relationship to what is at hand. Today, this may be more relevant than ever, given the haptic gestures that are key to our smartphones swiping, but also our dating apps. It is these little hand gestures, from simply tapping or clicking a like or a heart, is the act of swiping left or right that makes a habit in repetition, addicting us, changing our behavior to the happy enthusiasm of corporate and government enterprise. If Heidegger was simply elaborating Husserl phenomenology, that'd be one thing. Were he only engaged with Hölderlin and his poetry, another thing, called the later Heidegger. But when it comes to Nietzsche, Heidegger more than meets his match, and I increasingly believe Heidegger ultimately misjudges Nietzsche as many do. And for me, that misassessment begins with Nietzsche's critique of truth, what Heidegger, for his part, called aletheia. That's true. The Hallelujah Effect appeared in 2013, with a great paperback edition in 2016. Music, performance practice, and technology is the subtitle. The Hallelujah Effect is really three books in one, and maybe it would have been better if I had broken them up and written three books, one on desire, the second on Adorno and music, and the third on Nietzsche's Greeks instead. But I wrote them all together. The first part, the first part of the book, is on the difference in desire as such, that is, the difference between male and female desire. Thus, although the Hallelujah is clearly Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah, and not only was Leonard Cohen a famous ladies' man, by which I mean that he cheated on, which means that he betrayed, all the women in his life, but the Hallelujah is explicitly and first and foremost a song of praise. Thus, it is the singer's song, a secret David song, significant with respect to the claims the singer makes for himself and his relationship with his God. This is crucially his God. Even Suzanne, the Leonard Cohen song I also talk about in the Hallelujah Effect, is thus as a person named in the song related to a male who knows her, for whom she brings tea and the oranges that, we remember the words, come all the way from China. But the key point here is that the song is not about Suzanne in the way of Carly Simon's You're So Vain, which is in fact not only about Carly Simon, but very much about the object of desire in question, the guy about whom, who was it? Was it Warren Beatty? It turns out it was, as one perhaps already could have guessed, or Governor Jerry Brown, etc. But for Cohen, and this is maybe the difference with a male author, the Hallelujah is not about the woman King David sees bathing on their roof. It's not about her beauty, not about the moonlight, but David's passion for Bathsheba. It's a song about male desire. The focus on Katie Lang in my book was made, and I had to do it, not only given her ability to sing this particular song, but her ability to sing this passion, which my musicologist musicological correspondent, a professor of music at Brooklyn College, that was Ernest McLean, Ernie McLean, kept telling me, quite to my annoyance, that as analyzed, Hallelujah, musically speaking, was just programmatic music, calculated to be a hit, popular, and no big deal from a musical theoretical viewpoint. Thus, as I said, that disappointed me, but I'm sure he was right. Although I was very interested in raising the question of programming taste and consciousness, I was also seeking, which is why I was disappointed, the question of, to a certain extent, of desire, embodiment, performance practice, to ask what a woman might need to be able to sing a song of desire at all, even when singing the words of a man's song. Male and female desire are difficult matters, and women tend to seek to be desired rather than to desire as such. I'm not saying, I am a phenomenologist after all, that women don't desire. That they do, but the object can be a problem for them. Men are not keen on being the object of desire. It bothers them for all the reasons Hegel tells us, for all the insights that can be found in Kate Manna's justly celebrated book, Down Girl, The Logic of Misogyny. What is essentially lacking, and this is needed to talk about incels, and the culture of incels as she means to do in her book, is a discussion of both male desire and female desire, where the most subversive thing remains, and I would cite Luce Irigaray, if I am also fairly sure she wouldn't agree with my formulation, on female desire of the male, that idea, on a purely physical, purely erotic, purely or sheerly aesthetic level. But that would be a different conversation on a different theme. Covers. Yes, to be sure. That's the programming I was just referring to. The old Frankfurt School, pre-Habermas, pre-Hanleth and company, but focused on the mechanism that is what they called the culture industry, as this includes the music industry, film industry, television, video, HBO, YouTube, Instagram, etc., using it as today's culture industry has been doing for more than half a century, almost three quarters of a century, in fact, to sell you your own desire. In part, to use a now dated popular meme, this is your brain on the internet. Waking up and checking social media first thing, Twitter, this may be the first in many people's routine, certainly Trump thinks so, or checking email or Facebook to see what's happening, to see if anyone sought to contact you, by which I am, and very important, I'm not including texting, and if you're in a relationship that can involve a lot of texting, even having children can do that, and stay in close touch very fast. But there is a different culture, the digital culture, related, as Walter Benjamin argued, to works of art, as this differs, and Benjamin did not write about this because he didn't live long enough to see the transformations of our age, or our ages, better said, of technological reproducibility. One has to go beyond Benjamin to his friend Adorno, and even more, so I argue, Benjamin's own cousin, I think he was second cousin, Gunther Anders, who paid a lot of attention to the soul transforms, as it were, in the age of what Anders called the second and subsequently in his 1980 book on the same topic, the third industrial or technological revolution. These revolutions are mediated, according to Anders, by our own dedicated cooperation with the process. We work harder on this production of ourselves and our engagement with this. This is why it's perhaps called social media, than at our actual jobs. Anders argued that we worked on ourselves in order to manufacture ourselves on behalf of corporate industry, producing ourselves all by ourselves as consumers and paying for the instruments, that would be a smartphone or whatever brand you happen to fancy, a tablet, a laptop, plus broadband or cable, which you also have to pay for just to do it. In addition, we spend our time giving Facebook or Twitter or Google feedback. Simply just using your smartphone to check something out, research something, or to navigate directions will do that, cueing the kind of ads you presumably want to see. We are all thus precisely what Anders called home workers, 24/7, working for no pay, at home, on our own time, creating, curating, we say, a vision of ourselves in the image of the technologically savvy, with an opinion on everything, up to date about everything, and crafting at all times, this is especially true of professional philosophers, just the right internet presence. One further point on that, and this is, of course, an illustration of the same, object illustration. If we as academics fail to do so, we fail to have impact. I live part-time in the UK, where scholars are told they need to have impact on social media. Opting out is not an option. And if you publish a book, your publisher will remind you of the desirability of the same point. You have to be on Twitter. Even Umberto Eco, he of medieval scholarship fame, he of the name of the rose, was, when he was still alive, on Twitter. I was invited to give a lecture on the culture of the cover at the Orpheus Institute in Ghent. And there are great musicologists there who asked me, after I gave my lecture, for a definition of the musical cover. So I wrote an article on this in the music industry, inasmuch as remix and other things have changed the way we relate to music, but also owing to copyright, as this affects everything. Thus, monetization and penalties are the new eternal return, the new rent. If you buy your music digitally, you don't own it, even after you pay for it. This is like software. This is an artifact of Windows, that is Sony, leaving little cookies to track you such that, as it were, all your bass are belong to Sony, to remix or various subculture meme of yesteryear. This is the problem of digital culture. Microsoft is dedicated to making you a fan, consumer, subscriber, on the model of cable television or electricity providers, paying via annual and increasingly more substantial fees. In addition, of course, and this is the point of mentioning the Frankfurt School of the original pre-Habermas kind, that's Adorno, as the culture industry, and Horkheimer, is the programming industry, because as many authors point out, music is all we need, and not a lot of it. Just a few notes of a jingle will do to prime us or connect a certain feeling, mood, what have you. It's the programmability that is the problem. Anything else? This is a lovely question to ask as a last question after the cover question. Is there more to cover? When it comes to the phenomenology of sound, of the acoustic related to music as such, but also given that this is a reprise of an interview for the sake of the acoustic, I'm currently exploring a current project on the, it's really constantly ongoing, phenomenology of a response that not everyone has to a particular acoustic or in some cases visual stimulus, that is ASMR, autonomous sensory meridian response, both because this is a sensitivity to the sensible, sight and sound are part of this, as this is a video phenomenon, that one can have or that one cannot have. As a question of sense and sensibility or sensitivity, like anything else that involves the senses, it has its affordances, and it also has its numbing over time. This, technically, is called accommodation, a neurological phenomenon. One's senses respond less and less over time. In this case, what makes things a little more interesting and a great deal more connected to the so-called hallelujah effect is that this now widespread YouTube ASMR phenomenon is also a question. These things are free, or at least they seem to be. But of course, they're monetized, and thus those who make these videos, like all in the genre of influencers or wannabes, are passionately keen on getting commercial success. This, in philosophy, we know from various podcasts. This would include Nigel Warburton, Philosophy Bites, who's very successful. This is also the Jordan Peterson phenomenon, and it can work. I think the Peterson-Zizek debate made both of them considerable money. And thus, this is related to other peripheral phenomena of the culture industry on YouTube, professors of psychology or philosophy on YouTube. But here there is, not unrelated to the need to do a phenomenology of ASMR, a thing that's truly new. Video publication is publication. Podcasts likewise. Thus, for a classical example, the chance to see videos of Gadamer, my old teacher, on YouTube is a complete and unalloyed pleasure. Thus, other presentations likewise, and some of them can be, but last not all of them, useful for teaching and useful for research. But that too would take a whole other conversation. Do I have other study fields, plans? This is an optimistic final question, but there happens to be an optimistic answer. I'm finishing a book, also featuring the philosophical anthropology and sociology of music from a phenomenological point of view, as it turns out, a book on Anders and his theories on technology and music. I'm also researching the climate phenomenon of geoengineering, as we in the United States have been engaged in climate manipulation for years, not only in warfare, obviously engaged into terrible effect during the Vietnam War, but also elsewhere. Thus, I am interested in the relation, as the Dutch-German philosopher Peter Sloterdijk, who also writes on this, between today's political talk of global warming and climate change and the tendency at the same time to eschew all talk of weather manipulation or geoengineering. This is part of programming, because the term geoengineering is co-opted to mean not what we're currently doing to manipulate weather all over the world, but to plan in the future governmental interventions to what is imagined to be anthropogenic climate change. We're keeping track of agency. Who does what is the challenge. It's very problematic, especially given the announced release of 5G and so on. To that, I should add that I just finished a book, an edited book collection, with De Gruyter in Berlin, entitled Reading David Hume's of the Standard of Taste. If congenial others can be found, one always needs collaborators for projects, I am interested in using hermeneutic methods to approach the question of economics for the theoretical sake of the philosophy of science, to ask whether economics, which Thomas Carlyle named the dismal science, is a science at all. And there are further projects, some in German, on Nietzsche's Greeks, and so on, which is the life of what Nietzsche called joyful scholarship. My thanks to Beth Matthews for conducting the radio interview, and to Matthew Schottenfeld for his videography. Thank you very much.